Diane?
Yes.
Is the recorder on?
Everything is ready.
Okay, we ready to start?
Sounds like it.
Okay. Yes, we're ready.
Great. I'd like to call to order the March 15th, 2021 Delray Beach Planning and Zoning Meeting. Can you call the roll, please, Diane?
Max Weinberg. Absent. Alan Zeller.
Here. Diane, it's hard for me to hear.
I can hear you, Alan. Julian Blankenship. Julian?
Here.
Thank you. Joy Howell?
Here.
Rob Long?
Here.
Chris Davey?
Here. Thank you very much. Can I ask, are there any changes to the agenda this evening?
No changes to the agenda.
Great, thank you. Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Motion on the end, please.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Second. Great. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. There's a definite.
Thank you. Next item we have is approval of the minutes. The first ones up are September 21st, 2020. Has everybody, let me first ask, has everybody had a chance to review the 3 minutes that are attached to the agenda?
Yes.
Well, I have a couple of questions regarding the agenda.
Excuse me, Mr. Zeller, you have to speak up a little.
Okay. I have a couple of comments regarding the meeting minutes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So are we at that on the agenda? Are we at?
Yes, we are.
Okay. So on the September 21st, 2020 meeting on the election of officers. It said the motion was carried 7-0, but I believe the vote was 5-2. And that's what it showed in the count above that.
Oh,
okay.
Thank you for that.
Great. We would just ask staff to just review that if they would, please.
Yes, thank you. That was our oversight.
Okay, Mr. Zeller.
And I have a question with regard to some of the motions that are listed on here. I know these are not verbatim, a verbatim account, such as a transcript of the minutes, but there were numerous conditions attached to our approval of the ordinance 20-50, which is the one that dealt with the construction, parking, and closing of the road. And how do we find out if those conditions related to the commissioner as a part of our vote? So in other words, we had asked as a condition that whether or not there were fees associated with an applicant, a developer to close the road, and we had asked whether or not there were other ordinances in other cities that were reviewed before it was presented to the commissioner. Well, I don't know if any of that was done. How do we find out if any of that was
done? We typically relay the board's recommendation to commission when something moves forward. And I don't recall that one specifically. So I can't speak specific to it, but that is what occurs at that time. Is your recommendation is relayed to commission, and then changes are made to an ordinance as appropriate as we're able to do so. And that's just a general statement.
Okay.
If there's something specific that you want me to check on, I can do that and get back to you.
Well, I was curious to know whether, as part of the conditions, we asked if there were fees that are imposed to close the road. And I don't know whether that has been made it into the ordinance itself, or whether adopted that.
You, I don't, like I said, I just don't recall at this moment what the end result was. Okay.
Okay. And then are we going to vote on these separately, Mr. Chairman, these minutes, or together?
Excuse me, I would think we would vote on them since they're individually itemized. I would think we'd vote on them individually.
Correct.
Okay. So that's all I have on September 21st.
Excuse me?
That's all I have on September 21st. My only comment was to correct that one vote.
Okay, that's fine. That's fine. Do you want to comment on the other minutes now, as long as we're talking about all the minutes?
Sure, sure. The October 19th were okay. On November 16th, on item number 8, it says that ex parte communications that all board members spoke to Mr. Costello. I didn't speak to Mr. Costello. And on, that was 8A. And then on 8B, it says ex parte communication. I visited the site, so that should be noted on there as well.
Okay.
We can make those clarifications.
They can make those corrections, Mr. Zeller.
And I do want to say thank you for reading the minute.
I always welcome. I always read them.
Yeah.
And then on the on page 7 at the very end, there's just a typo in there at the very last line. Uh-huh. The discussion by Julian Bankenship. The motion was made by Julian Blankenship, seconded, it says, by Alan Rob Long, so that was just a correction.
Okay.
Great. That's it, Mr. Zeller?
That's it.
Okay, do any other members of the board have comments, revisions, or additions to the 3 minutes that are on our agenda? Hearing no response, I'll say nobody else does. That being said, can I then get a motion on the first approval of the first set of minutes? Item A.
Second.
Great, Diane, could you call the roll, please? 4A.
Chair, if you want on these, you can just do it all in favor.
All in favor? Okay, great. Item 4A. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Great. Item 4A passes. Item 4B. All in favor, please?
Aye.
Aye.
We still
all opposed?
No, nope. Chair, just one second. We still need the motion and a second.
Great. Can I get a motion and a second on 4B?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Julian Blankenship, seconded by Joy Howell. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? The ayes have it. Can I get a motion on 4C, please?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Joy, motion by Julen Blankenship, seconded by Joy Howell. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. All opposed? Great. Okay, the item passes 4C. Next will be swearing in of the public, and I will read the quasi-judicial rules, if that is okay. Diane, is there one you'd prefer to do first? Would you rather I read the rules, or would you rather swear everybody in?
Just a reminder, we keep that in the agenda, but because of the virtual nature. We swear in at each individual item.
Item. Okay, that's what I thought, Mr. Bennett. Should I bother reading the quasi-judicial rules or just wait until the item comes?
You can go ahead and read them now since you have them up.
Perfect. This hearing shall be conducted in accordance with the City of Delray Beach quasi-judicial rules. The applicant and the city shall be permitted to present their case. The public shall be allowed to speak for 3 minutes each, or a maximum of 6 minutes if the person represents an organization or a group of people who are present but agree not to speak. The City Commission, board members and staff, and the applicant may be allowed to cross-examine a witness. The city or applicant will also be allowed to offer rebuttal testimony. The decision to approve or deny an application or appeal may not legally be made upon personal views as to whether the project is a good project or not, nor may a decision be based upon the number of citizens who support or oppose a particular project. The law requires that all decisions must be made on the basis of whether the project meets the requirements of law, the comprehensive plan, and the land development regulations. Thank you. And having said that, we can move on to comments from the public. Can I ask, were there any comments for the public not on agenda items received prior to the meeting today?
No, there was not.
Great. So hearing there was no public comment, we can move right into item 7A, which is presentations, Florida Bicycle Month activities in March. Staff, I'll hand it to you.
If I can, real quick, before I before Brian starts presenting, I just wanted to make a note that our assistant city manager is on our meeting with us. Duncan Tavares joined us, I believe, last month, and he was actually in our meeting in the beginning of it as well. But unfortunately, I didn't get to introduce him to you all. So he has joined us for our meeting again this month, and so I want to definitely make a note of that for you all to see.
Great. Welcome.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chief. Is Duncan there? Is he going to say, or can I go ahead? And I have lost you all, so.
Is Mr. Tavares going to say something, or are we going right to Mr. Rusher?
I just want to say thank you again for all of your time and your participation in this process. It's an invaluable process for the city. So it's been nice to sort of watch your deliberation and follow the process through the different channels here in the city. So thank you.
Well, on behalf of the other board members, welcome to Delray Beach. Brian, on that, we can hand it over to you.
Thank you. So I will be very brief in my presentation. This is just to give you an overview of some of the activities that we have going on this month. As some of you may or may not know, I still have my camera on and I can see all of you. March in Florida is known as Florida Bicycle Month. We proclaim Florida Bicycle Month in March, 2 months ahead of National Bicycle Month, because as you can tell, the weather is just absolutely great in Florida right now for biking. So we get a little bit ahead of everybody else because biking in May is when it starts to get a little bit hotter. But in doing so, we also decided to partner up with our partner agencies and some private agencies to put together some COVID safe activities for consideration and participation by the board. So I'm going to dive into that and just give you a brief explanation. Should take about 5 to 10 minutes and give you an opportunity for questions as well. So why Florida Bicycle Month? So every year the state of Florida proclaims Florida Bicycle Month in the month of March. This is something that the governor does and calls upon municipalities to do. It's driven largely in part to our awesome, like I said, weather, but also the nature that we have in Florida. We have an excessive amount of trails and parks and greenway systems to explore. Locally, we have a number of really great bicycle routes to participate in, namely along A1A, along Atlantic Avenue in the downtown area. And of course, our comprehensive plan has numerous goals and educational objectives that relate to bicycling and providing transportation choices to people. So some of the benefits of cycling, you know, this year we tried to focus it on students, you know, in particular. So the physical activity guidelines are really important for children, and especially during COVID, with more and more people doing everything from home behind a screen, it's really hard to get people to sit and concentrate. But it's been shown time and again that, you know, if you meet the physical activity guidelines, doing 30 minutes of activities a day, it increases childhood concentration, which increases test performance and increases concentration on the topic that they're doing. So really important. I mean, biking in Florida is just one way to meet these guidelines. And this month we're highlighting Bicycle Month as part of that. Some of the other metrics on here, of course, you know, you get 300 calories burned for every 30 minutes of bicycling. So that's great. It's almost a meal when you think about it. And then it's also more energy efficient. So what do we have going on this month? As I said before, we are partnering with a number of different agencies, the DDA, Say What Enterprise, which is what runs Healthier Delray Beaches, Let's Move Palm Beach County Initiative. This is a competitive effort between all of the municipalities, the school district of Palm Beach County, and a couple of other organizations to basically log as many exercise minutes as possible. And as I said before, we're partnering and kind of working around the theme of schools. But every week in the month of March, we have a different topic that we're asking people to bike about, log in, post on social media, and log your miles through letsmovepbc.com. This week, we are focusing on bike to work. We posted a couple of times on our Facebook and social media, and our partners have done the same. It's really easy to go in and log your miles under letsmovepbc.com. Under the subteam Florida Bicycle Month, we in the city of Delray Beach, we have over 2 million minutes logged between all the different participants, between the Victor Strawn walk and other Palm Beach County School District promoted activities. We have a lot of time being spent outside right now, which is great because it's COVID safe and it's also increasing, you know, childhood physical activity, which is incredibly important. Another activity that we are going to post is a ribbon cutting and a bike ride. This will be a in-person event with limited capacity that we're only spreading to a few of our boards. You're the lucky ones on the planning side. It's been presented to the education board and to planning and zoning board. So this is an invite only by word of mouth. You can RSVP at the hyperlink shown on the screen. If anybody is interested or can't get to it, just shoot me an email. That email will be provided on the last slide. This date is March 30th. We're going to do a very short, easy, about 1.5 to 2 mile bike ride from Bankers Row all the way up Northeast 2nd Avenue, which is also known as Seacrest. It's an incredible project. The beautification is now complete. It's included landscaping, drainage improvements, sidewalk, closing the sidewalk gaps up Seacrest Avenue, and of course the green bike lanes, which the community's really come to love. Just a quick note about this, as I said before, what helps people choose to bike, especially students and their parents? What will make parents feel safe with their students being able to bike? And I think it's important to also draw the parallel here to also people driving. People want a safe, direct, and a comfortable and interesting route. That also applies to people bicycling. You know, if you have to take more than a 10% or 20% detour on your trip when you're bicycling or you're driving, that takes away the directness of the route and it makes it pretty inconvenient. So it's important to think about infrastructure improvements in this way. And it's why Seacrest Avenue really enshrines a direct route to school as a really important means to getting people to have a choice in their transportation options. We also think about things that are safe. You know, we want cars to abide by the speed limits, people to take turns in a safe manner. And Seacrest really will help to, I think, show the safe and direct route improvements. Beyond that, you also want to make sure it's comfortable and interesting, especially with a note on bicycle racks being at the end of trip facilities. So we are also doing a walking audit, which is separate. This event's already capped and met capacity, but I wanted to bring it to your all's attention. We will report out on this. Has anybody ever heard of a walking audit before? A chance? Any hands? I'm looking for hands. I know a lot of cameras are still off. But a walking audit is essentially where you go out with students and you ask them to make points about what would make it better and easier for them to cross the street. So we're doing this to try to identify walking and bicycling conditions along Banyan Creek along Barwick Road. We have a project that's located between Atlantic Avenue and Lake Ida. This will be a follow-up walking audit to go along with that. So if anyone is really interested about that, let me know. And if we have people that are dropping off, we'll absolutely see if we can get one of you guys in to this walking audit. So I said I'd be brief, and that's all I have. So I wanted to ask if anybody has any follow-up questions for me or if anybody has any particular points of interest that they wanted to discuss. I don't see any hands.
Members of the board, does anybody have any questions for Brian? I don't see any, Brian. You're getting off easy.
Will you be sending a link? Will you be sending a link to us to sign up for that the biking event at the end of the month?
I certainly can. What I can do, if it's okay with Amy, is I'll blind carbon copy all of the board with the RSVP form, so it's a little easier for you to get to.
Perfect.
Amy's nodding her head. Yeah, so I'll go ahead and do that now before I leave.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, Brian.
Appreciate you all letting me come and take over your meeting for a short amount of time. I appreciate it.
You got it. Have a great night.
Yes, you as well.
Okay, before we move on to item 8A, I would like to just ask Diane. Diane, I was contacted by Max Weinberg during Brian's presentation, and he's been trying to get in for a half an hour. Is there somebody from IT who could like call him or something?
Yes, I will call IT.
Okay, if you could. He said he got like a glimpse of it for a minute, but it just won't connect for him.
Okay.
So I want to keep the meeting moving, obviously, but if somebody could just see if they could help him, that'd be great. Okay?
Sure. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Diane. And with that being said, let's move on A, which would be Pop Stroke, file number 2021-088. And I think we have Ms. Slasky making the presentation.
Chair, while they're getting set up, maybe ask about ex parte.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bennett. Does anybody have any ex parte communication to disclose?
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
It's Julian. Julian, for the record. I spoke with development services staff. I spoke with the city attorney's office, and I also drove by the subject property.
Thank you. Anybody else?
This is Joy. I did have a conversation with another golf course, a similar golf course nearby, asking about some of the environmental impacts and sorry, how things work for that business, a similar business, not exact. And I also drove by the site.
Okay, anybody else?
I visited the site as well.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, I'm not sure if it's germane to the ex parte communication side, but I did look up the Pop Stroke online and on their social media sites to see what they offer, just in case that, you know, that should be disclosed. So
I don't know what it should be.
And an abundance of caution.
Caution. So, that's a better way to put it. Exactly. better from the side.
You know, I looked up online as well and looked up their Port St. Lucie location and just to see what it looked like and the setup and what the general aesthetic was online. But I don't know if that's worth, again, in an abundance of caution, I did the same.
Thank you, Mr. Long. I have to tell you, I did not look at anything online, but I have driven past the site. Not a special trip, but I oftentimes go up to northbound Federal Highway to hit that big Walmart. So that's my disclosure of ex parte. And let's see, is Ms. Slasky ready to go? Ms. Slasky?
Yes, can you?
Yes, we can.
Okay, is it loud and clear?
Crystal clear.
Okay, thank you. I was having some troubles before. If I can share the presentation, Diane, please. Thank you. And Mr. Covalli, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Okay, thank you. All right, good evening, board. For the record, this is item 8A. It is a conditional use for Pop Stroke. It is file number 2021-088. I will follow up with staff's report and presentation after the applicant and the agent present. We have Mr. Covalli representing the applicant, and he'll be presenting first.
Great. Can I ask Diane, Mr. Covalli, before you start your presentation, Diane, has everybody been sworn on this item?
No, we have not.
If we could please get everybody sworn. Thank you.
Please raise your right hand. By the authority vested in me, the notary of the state of Florida, do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Covalli, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Deborah, are you going to run this? I guess I'll just tell you when to switch slides. Okay. Good evening. I'm Mike Covalli with Covalli Design Associates, 1209 South Swinton Avenue in Delray Beach. The item before you is a request for conditional use to permit a miniature golf use on approximately 1 acre of the subject property. Next slide, please. The entire property is located west of Federal Highway, east of Dixie Highway, which is adjacent to the FEC railroad tracks. And you can see at the top of the page the relationship to Northeast 14th Street, where that is. Next slide. This slide, you can see the location of the proposed miniature golf site in the dark green at the south end at the bottom of the right-hand image. The image to the left is to show you that 10 feet of right-of-way is being dedicated along Federal Highway with the 10-foot special landscape strip that's required by the land development regulations. If you look at the image to the right, I don't know if you can see it very well, but the landscape strip goes around the south side of the property and on up Dixie Highway. If you notice the relationship to the areas, at the south, you have the proposed miniature golf, which is the subject of this site. And then there is a green area before the building, which is an outdoor play area. And I'm telling you this because it will come up later on in the presentation when you see relationships. So I'm just doing this very quickly. This is not site plan approval. Then you see the building and then you see the parking lot. Next slide, please. This shows the specific limits of the conditional use. The parcel is surrounded on roadways by three sides. The area is approximately 1 acre in size. The perimeter buffer and fencing will be around the perimeter of this problem. Next slide. As some background information, I wanted to show you the concept, the entire project, to add the context, and later you'll see it's necessary to demonstrate some of the conditional use criteria. However, this is only for the miniature golf conditional use, and the remainder of this will have to be approved by a site plan. So quickly, the overall site's 3 acres, 1 acre of which is the miniature golf. In addition to the golf, there's a 4,500 square foot restaurant that's open air, 2,000 square feet of outdoor gaming area, a golf shop, a playground, fire pits, parking. The golf course was designed by Tiger Woods, and I'd like to play a quick video. Next slide. If you click on the black square, I think, and then hit the play button. Nope, go back. See, click right there. There you go. No sound. Oh, well. This just gives you some images of what the facility would look like. There in particular was the golf area. That's the outdoor play area. There's again the golf area. This is one of the other sites. So go ahead, next slide. I'll just show you some images quickly just for context. This is the architecture of the building. This is what the golf center looks like with ice cream. Continue. Ice cream. Next, this is basically what the golf area will look like. It's landscaped. The putting area is AstroTurf. Semi-pervious so that there is drainage. Next slide. Then there's just the restaurant. You see the relationship to the golf area from the restaurant. Next slide. This is the outdoor play area. Next slide. And the playground. Next slide. So now we're going to get into the conditional use request and in the issues related to it. The request is being made as per section 4.4.9D11 of the Land Development Regulations, which requires recreational establishments to file and process a conditional use request. Miniature golf courses are one of the uses specified in the code that require such a request be made. Required findings must be made in evaluating the request for conditional use. There are a number of code sections that are applicable and positive findings must be made in relationship to the review criteria. The first item is compliance with the land use map. The property is designated commercial on the land use map. The proposed miniature golf use is a commercial use, which is consistent with the land use map. Therefore, positive findings can be made for compliance with the land use map. The next criteria is concurrency, which is an evaluation of traffic, water and sewer, solid waste, stormwater management, schools, parks, and open space. The traffic analysis has been prepared and submitted to Palm Beach County and has been approved by Palm Beach County. There's capacity available to service the project with water and sewer. An analysis for stormwater management has been submitted to the city showing compliance. As a non-residential use, there's no impact on schools. And as related to parks and open space, again, as a non-residential project, this will not affect capacity. However, the miniature golf does provide a private recreation option and open space. Therefore, positive findings can be made with regards to concurrency. Next slide. Another criteria to evaluate the project is consistency. The comprehensive plan has goals, policies, and objectives listed to be utilized as a guide for development or redevelopment. There are a number of policies applicable to this proposed miniature golf use. The policies listed reference the complementary mix of land uses. I showed you earlier the proposed uses for a very constrained site as being miniature golf with an outdoor game area and restaurant adjacent to the miniature golf and parking adjacent to the restaurant. The outdoor game area serves as transition between the miniature golf and the restaurant. North of the restaurant is a parking lot, which serves as a transition to the existing retail to the facility to the north. This proposed development pattern provides for compatibility with the intensity and uses within this area sandwiched between two roadways. There is a residential neighborhood to the west of Old Dixie and the FEC railroad tracks that can utilize this proposed use of miniature golf to meet the needs for outdoor recreation. Positive findings can be made with for consistency with this policy. Another policy references development patterns arranged to achieve compatibility. As I just explained, the transition of the uses as organized achieve a compatible development pattern. Looking at the general area and federal highway corridor, it is designated for commercial use with some multifamily, which is compatible with the proposed miniature golf use. The area to the west side of Dixie Highway and the FEC railroad tracks is single family residential. The distance from the site taken up by the right of way for Dixie Highway, the FEC railroad, and then Northeast 4th Avenue west of the railroad provides distance between the uses. Fencing, landscaping, controlled lighting, and noise will also be utilized to provide proper buffering for the residential use to the west of the railroad. Positive findings can be made for consistency with this policy. The next policy references appropriate intensity. This project will have approximately 60% open space. As a site with commercial zoning and land use designation, could have a building with a maximum height of 48 feet and 75% of the lot could be covered with building and parking, which is much higher intensity than is being proposed for as a miniature golf use. Positive findings can be made for consistency with this policy. Next slide, please. Another policy references encouraging and supporting recreation and physical activity by continuing to provide a system of open space, activity-based parks, resource-based recreation facilities, and diverse programming options for all ages. Miniature golf provides open space and is a recreational activity for all ages. Positive findings can be made for the consistency with this policy. Another policy to evaluate references the promotion of redevelopment of vacant properties, particularly those that can serve as a catalyst to economic development. As you know, there is not a lot of new development in the north end of town where this project is located. Development of this parcel will continue the redevelopment along the corridor and will be a destination use that will bring people into the area that can serve as a catalyst for future development of underutilized parcels in the area. If you drive up and down Federal Highway, you will see a lot of for sale signs. Positive findings can be made for consistency within this policy. Another policy addresses citing the appropriate private recreation within the city. This parcel is very narrow with restricted access and is not conducive to conventional commercial development. The miniature golf use physically fits within the site and provides private recreational use option in the northern part of town. Positive findings to be made for consistency with this policy. The final policy references promoting commercial developments to create space for social interaction and entertainment. Miniature golf is a commercial use that provides outdoor recreation that is a family oriented and it encourages interaction amongst the participants. As demonstrated in the past two slides, positive findings can be made for consistency of all these items. Next slide, please. The next criteria to be evaluated is compliance with land development regulations. Earlier, I showed you a slide of the proposed site plan, and you should have the site plan in your backup material. The site plan is not a topic of this application. However, in order to show you compliance that the LERs could be achieved, the site plan was prepared to demonstrate that compliance can be achieved. One item related to the site plan is since the plan was sent to you in your packet, the engineering department has required us to dedicate 10 feet of right-of-way on Dixie Highway. The plan I showed you shows that dedication and everything still works within that with no degradation in parking that was shown on your plan. I showed you that earlier in the presentation and miniature that this can be accomplished. With regards to the criteria related to compliance with LDRs, all of the criteria can be complied with, including exceeding parking and open space requirements. Therefore, positive findings can be made related to compliance with land development regulations. In addition, there are criteria for which the City Commission must make positive findings in relation to this conditional use. The first item is the conditional use will not have a significantly detrimental effect on the stability of the neighborhood within which it will be located. The proposed use is of a much lower intensity as is possible as a commercial development. The miniature golf will be a destination for family-oriented outdoor recreation, which brings people into the area to provide natural surveillance of the area through increased activity and more eyes on the property in the general area. As a destination use, the development of the site can contribute to the development pattern in the area and serve as a catalyst for future development in the area. Therefore, the condition will not have a detrimental effect on the stability of the neighborhood. The second item is the development of the site will not hinder development or redevelopment of nearby properties. As demonstrated earlier, the site is surrounded by roadways on three sides, resulting in a very constrained and isolated parcel for development. The development of the site will not hinder the development or redevelopment of nearby properties by virtue of the location and configuration. As demonstrated in this presentation, positive findings can be made for Chapter 3 performance standards, development regulations, Section 3.1.1, and Section 2.4.5, E5, A and B of the land development regulations. Therefore, a positive recommendation for approval of the conditional use can be made, and I would respectfully request that you make that recommendation. Thank you. I'm here for questions.
Mr. Covelli, I will now hand it off to staff for their presentation.
Mr. Chairman, Max Weinberg here, and I'm on.
You're on. Great. I'm glad you were able to join us, Mr. Weinberg.
Thank you. It was a challenge, but I'm here.
Okay. Ms. Slasky? I see she has a funny icon where she is, like she's not connected.
Give me 1 minute. You can hear me, right?
Yes, we can, Ms. Lasky. Okay. Yes, we can. Take your time. By the time we all get used to the technical specifics of this process, we'll be back to in-person meetings.
Diane, am I still the presenter? I don't see an option for me to share my screen.
Your screen is already shared, Ms. Slasky. It's already on the display, and it says viewing Deborah Slasky's screen.
Do you see the black presentation with pop strobe on it?
Yes, I do.
But can you see me? You cannot see me, right?
We don't see you. I get a message that says low bandwidth. The video will appear when it can. But we can hear you and we can see the presentation.
That's all we need, right?
That's right.
All right.
I didn't say that.
So I will try not to repeat everything that Mr. Cavalli said. So the site is a 3-acre site, and it includes 5 parcels located between Old Dixie Highway and North Federal Highway. The property is addressed at 1314 North Federal Highway. Some of the history for the site, it has been vacant for a while. The most recent approved use was before 1993, used to be a gasoline station. It was a Chevron gasoline station. In 1993, they received permits to remove all the underground structures. So since then, it has been vacant. Some of you might have driven by recently and seen cars on this property. About almost 2 years ago, March 12, 2019, the City Commission granted a temporary use for the site to be used as a temporary parking lot. and it was vacated a few months ago, and as of today, it has been vacant. So the request in front of the board tonight is a recommendation to the City Commission regarding a conditional use request. The request is to allow a recreational establishment as a miniature golf course containing two 18-hole courses on the property at 1314 North Federal Highway. The development includes two 18-hole courses, a parking lot with 117 parking spaces, a restaurant structure with outdoor areas. The building is approximately 4,500 square feet, and it is a two-story building. There's going to be a children's play area and another building, which is going to be connected to the restaurant, which is going to be used for the registration admissions for the golf course. The proposed hours of operations are Sunday through Wednesday from 10 a.m. until 11 p.m., Thursday through Saturday from 10 a.m. through 12 p.m. The conditions for the board, the conditions that the board can impose tonight can be as necessary to ensure compatibility with the nearby existing and proposed uses. The board has the option to impose conditions with regards to concurrency of the use, such as how utilities and services will be provided. And also the board can impose conditions to ensure fulfillment of requirements as applicable. One other condition that can be made is with regards to the limitations of hours of operations and the longevity of the use. So here are some of the findings that are required for the board to be making tonight. These are findings pursuant to LDR section 3.11, require findings. Prior to approval of development application, certain findings must be made in a form which is part of the official record. The following findings relate to consistency with the land use map, concurrency, comprehensive plan consistency, and compliance with the LDR. With regards to A, land use map, as Mr. Cavalli stated, the miniature golf course is allowed as a conditional use in the general commercial zoning district. The general commercial zoning district is consistent with the general commercial land use designation. With regards to B, concurrency, a determination made that the public facility needs will be met is required. This is in regards to water, sewer, drainage, and solid waste services. In your staff report, it is noted that they can be accommodated, and further details are required during site plan review. I just wanted to reinstate what Mr. Cavalli said. A traffic study was provided, which demonstrates that 284 daily trips will be generated by the proposed use, and a traffic performance standards review letter issued by the Palm Beach County Traffic Division was provided, which indicates that the proposal meets the concurrency standards. With regards to C, consistency, a finding of overall consistency with the LDRs and the comprehensive plans needs to be made. And in this slide and the next one, you see some of the policies that we would like to bring to your attention. On this slide, you have three policies from the neighborhood, district, and corridor element from the comprehensive plan adopted about a year ago. They relate to complementary uses within the area, transition between land uses designations, and the use intensity have to be appropriate with the area and the surroundings. Here you have a policy from Healthy Community, which just states that we encourage and support recreation uses with physical activities and they have open space elements. And from the economic prosperity element, we promote development that would be a catalyst for economic development. So as stated in your staff report, that is an analysis that provides a review of the North Federal Highway redevelopment plan for this area. The plan is a little bit outdated. It was adopted in 1999, but there's still some relevant information that should be brought to your attention. And some of those include the desired goals for the community and the ideal development for the area. So I'm just gonna bring to your attention that in the plan, it states that residents desire the elimination of blight through redevelopment of the area with a healthy mix of commercial and residential development. The plan also states that the community wanted the cars, pedestrian, and bicycle traffic to be able to be developed in a cohesive way. And this area has not seen a lot of development throughout the years. However, it is changing little by little. The plan is a little out to date, but the proposal still has to comply with the findings and the goals in the plan. So what else can I share with you? The plan does talk a lot about this area being contributing to the blight. There was, and there's still a lot of vacant properties and properties that need to be redeveloped to uplift the area. Let's see what else. All right, so next slide. This one is required finding the compliance with the LDRs. As Mr. Cavalli said, there is a number of requirements that have to be complied. At this time, we're not able to identify all of them because the plan provided is just a preliminary plan, but we were able to determine that the setbacks were met, open space was met, the FAR floor area ratio was also met, the building height is below the minimum required. We do have some concerns about the proposed setbacks that is identified in your staff report. It is in compliance with just the goal of the setbacks for this area is to bring the building closer to the street to enhance the streetscape. So that is something that SPREB would have to consider at the time of site plan. We also asked the applicant to comply with the night hours reduction and safety requirements in terms of lighting. The staff report states the parking requirement as a total of 109 spaces required for all the uses, including the restaurant and the miniature golf course. And the site plan indicates that 117 parking spaces are proposed. So they're proposing more spaces than required. With regards to the right-of-way requirement, in your staff report, there's a note that states that the Development Services Management Group, the SMG, would meet and consider a reduction to the right-of-way along Old Dixie Highway. We held a meeting last week, and the proposal to reduce the right-of-way along Dixie Highway was granted. Therefore, the applicant does not need to dedicate any land along Dixie Highway. However, as Mr. Cavalli stated, there is a right-of-way dedication along North Federalway that is being provided. That dedication is 10 feet, and the applicant does not have any concerns with that. Also, in your staff report, it is noted that the platting requirements will need to be addressed during site plan review. This parcel includes this property includes five different parcels, and we need a document which can be applied to unify all the lots as one development. So in addition to the findings in chapter 3, the board is being asked to make additional findings. These relate to a finding needs to be made that the conditional use will not have a significantly detrimental effect upon the stability of the neighborhood within which it will be located, hinder development or redevelopment of nearby properties. The development location is along a major corridor for the city, which is North Federal Highway. This highway connects the city from south to east. It runs through the downtown and connects us to Boca Raton and Boynton Beach and Gulf Stream. The site is adjacent to commercial plazas to the north, individual commercial buildings, including a vet clinic, personal services, business offices, and retail stores to the east and south, and residential neighborhoods, which is the Del Park and Seacrest neighborhood to the west, across the Florida East Coast Railroad and Northeast 3rd Avenue. On your screen, you can see the uses that I'm referring to. The proposed use is anticipated to contribute to the North Federal Highway Corridor, which is predominantly made up of commercial uses, as you can see. However, we ask the board to take a special consideration of the impacts to the residential neighborhood to the west. This image, the image to the right illustrates the site proximity to a residential neighborhood. The image also shows some details provided by the applicant for existing golf courses, the same use which is being proposed. What we can see based on the image provided is that the landscape buffering is not dense enough to provide an adequate buffer. And the majority of the trees that we see on the pictures are palm trees. We were not provided a landscape plan, so therefore we cannot provide any feedback on what is needed or what can be enhanced. So as I said, impacts on the residential neighborhood to the west with resulting from the outdoor noises that can be created by this use and associated improvements such as lighting should be considered by the board tonight. The board may consider requesting additional landscaping that includes shade trees with a wide full canopy spread or other type of landscaping that will provide a similar buffer and they are taller than the minimum requirements at the time of planting to mitigate impact from the noise and lighting, particularly along the west property line. This request will be brought to the CRA's attention on March 22nd, their next meeting. If they have any concerns, they'll contact staff and we'll provide a presentation. We do not have a city commission day yet. However, based on tonight's meeting and how the applicant decides to proceed with the request, we're able to schedule these items for April or May. And whenever the board is ready, I'll leave the motions on the screen for your consideration. There are four motions that can be made, one for approval, second approval with conditions, third denial. And if you choose to postpone this item, you may move to continue with direction. Thank you.
Great. Ms. Slasky, before we go on with the presentation, I just wanted to ask you one question. Could you go back three slides to where the map was with the residential neighborhood right there, the one that said 150 feet over to the residential neighborhood to the west? Can I ask you, though? There is a residential community of townhomes that is to the south and east of the project. Is that not correct?
Correct.
Okay.
It's right on the corner of your screen, right?
Right, but there's no delineation on that as a residential zoning district. And it would seem to me that that may even be closer than the residential zoning district to the west. But I'll leave that. I just wanted to make sure that my recollection was correct, that there is a resident.
We can discuss that. We're ready to bring it to the board's attention. Thank you.
Oh, perfect. Thank you, Ms. Slasky. Great. With that being said, can I ask Diane Miller, was there any public comment on this item? Should we pause to hear public comment or allow people to call in?
Yes, we do. We need to break for 5 minutes.
Perfect. Let's say right now it is 6:59. We'll regroup here at 7:05. Okay, we'll take a 5 minute adjournment.
Just a reminder, board members, you can turn your mic off and camera off as well.
That was my next statement, Mr. Bennett, but thank you for chiming in. See you back here at 7:05. Thank you, Diane. Just give it a minute for everybody to come back and turn their video on. Perfect. Diane, everyone's back. Was there any public comment on this item?
Yes, we have some public comment.
Okay, perfect. Start playing it. Okay. Thank you.
Hello, I was just sworn in. My name is Timothy Sullivan. I live at 831 Lake Avenue North, Delray Beach, Florida, 33483. I am commenting on the proposed development project of the mini golf course on Federal Highway just north of George Bush. I'm leaving my comments in opposition to the development for a number of reasons. The main one being the level of congestion already apparent on Federal Highway and in the general area, adding an establishment with 120 parking spaces there is going to cause significant congestion. I live just up the street. I am a homeowner in the community, property owner in the community, so I have some concerns about the increased congestion. I also question the need for a mini golf course when there is already an 18-hole mini golf course less than a mile up the road that is an establishment me and my family frequent often. I question the logic behind adding another very similar entertainment option in the area. So I do believe that's a great location for something to be developed. I question the logic of what is proposed and the scale and the scope and the congestion created by what is proposed for the space. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Cindy Jacobs. My address is 264 Northeast 13th Street in Delray Beach. And I'd like to leave a comment for the conditional use of Pop Stroke. I just wanted to mention that as this would be an outdoor business, there definitely will be some noise that will travel easily into the residential neighborhood. And I am in that west side, so that is where my concern is. In addition, the business serves alcohol, which also could be leading to a concern of noise, you know, from the patrons coming from that area. And with the late hours of Sunday through Wednesday till 11 p.m. and Thursday through Saturday till midnight, this will disturb the neighboring residents. And we recommend that earlier hours be taken into consideration. As an outdoor golf business, we're concerned about the large lights that will be used and a mention of a jumbotron, which we have not seen much data on. It could be disturbing the neighborhoods also. And most importantly is the safety along Dixie Highway and the railroad area. That corridor, people do cross the tracks, although they're not supposed to. And we recommend that there should be a wall along the tracks to avoid these pedestrian crossings. There should also be trees and bushes along Third Avenue to block the sound. Also, the Bright Line has killed many citizens, and although it's not in use currently, we know it will start up again, and that will be a safety concern. Lastly, if the restaurant allows takeout, there also would be a concern of litter from people, you know, removing it from the premises. Those are my considerations. Thank you so much for your time.
My name is Penny Perry. The address is 265 Northeast 13th Street, Delray. my comments concerning the proposed golf unit would be primarily safety. I'm concerned about the total openness of pedestrian walkthroughs cutting across the railway tracks. I feel that the restaurant may be open too late. I don't see why those hours need to be quite so late. That brings me to be concerned about picking up garbage from people who are coming back across from the facility. What is the accessibility on the west side? If there would be a closed-in fence or something so that there's less likelihood of people coming across. All these streets, 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th, all go straight into people's homes. The other thing would be the lights. Are the floodlights or the height of those lights? It's really just more of a safety thing, and the parking lot being on the north end, that's fine. But I would be a little concerned as to whether a lot of car lights, car headlights might be on the out. It's just late. It just seems to me that it's a little late. I'm glad that we don't have Brightline right now, because with that going on, I would just have visions of a lot of squashed people. I'm just concerned about the safety aspect of too much accessibility and no blockage coming off that west side onto that slip road.
Hi, my name is Pat Torcello. I live at 829 Lake Avenue North, Delray Beach. I'm calling about the Pop Stroke Development Project on North Federal Highway. I strongly object to this development. This type of establishment does not belong in La Hacienda neighborhood. We are a quiet family neighborhood and do not want this type of spring break party destination in the area. The bar is going to be open till midnight, so that means there's going to be a lot of loud music, and you'll be able to hear it for several blocks. We know this because we had a problem before with the yoga studio's loud parties on Federal Highway, and it was such a nuisance to residents in La Hacienda and in the neighborhood west of Federal Highway that we all made sure that that activity stopped. Also, we do not want hundreds of drunk partiers hanging around our neighborhood. Basically, this type of activity does not belong here. We do not want our neighborhood to turn into a mega party destination. Please respect the safe and quiet neighborhood that we have finally established that's free of halfway houses and loud partying, and do not allow this development. This is the Pop Stroke Project. Thank you so much.
Hello, my name is Deborah Sherman. I live at 831 Lake Avenue North, Delray Beach, 33483. I am calling to leave a comment on the conditional use for Pop Stroke at 1314 North Federal Highway, which is being considered this evening. I am firmly opposed to this development for a number of reasons. Number one, traffic congestion. This stretch of Federal Highway is already significantly congested, and I believe this development will impact that to a great degree, making it much worse. Number two, a parking lot of this size sounds extraordinary to me, and I believe is in conflict with climate resiliency planning for the city of Delray Beach. I understand the city has tree canopy goals, and this lot would be an ideal location to plan some reforestation. Something like that would be much preferred. Number three, a mini golf business consisting of two 18-hole courses already exists very close to this location, just a half mile north of here at Putt and Around, a long established Delray Beach institution. And I believe this new business would impact them negatively. For all of these reasons, I am very much opposed. I hope that whatever plan does move forward, that a significant portion of this parcel will be set aside for new tree plantings and reforestation. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Elise Johnson Nail. I was sworn in. I would like to leave a message regarding the conditional use for Pop Stroke on North Federal Highway in Delray Beach. My name is Elise Johnson Nail. I am the owner of Putt and Around Delray Beach, a mini golf course, a family owned and operated property for the last 11 years. We're located at 350 Northeast 5th Avenue, Delray Beach, Florida. And I live on Southeast 7th Avenue in Delray Beach, Florida. When I first heard that the golf course was coming, the Pop Stroke, I was concerned because it's only 11 blocks from my business. So my husband and I drove to Port St. Lucie to visit their location on Friday. I must say it looks and plays more like a golf course, you know, putting green. It is a beautiful facility offering lots of events inside and golf-related activities. I really think it'll be a good addition to Delray Beach. I think that we will be able to work together. We're slightly different, bringing more people downtown and off the avenue on a piece of property that's currently vacant. So my husband and I, as owners of Putnam on Delray Beach, are fully supportive. We do hope that this company understands that coming to Delray Beach is a small town. We hope that they participate in our town and give and help support to the local nonprofits in the community, such as the Achievement Center, the Skating Museum, Old School Square, etc. And I think that they will be a great addition. It is beautiful. It'll be pretty to look at driving down the street. So 100% for it. Thank you very much.
My name is Susan Miller. I have been sworn in. My address is 260 Northeast 14th Street in Delray Beach. I received the notification regarding Executive Order 20-69. My husband and I object to the approval of this double 18-hole mini golf course at 4,500 square foot building, restaurant, and parking lot for the following reasons. Number one, Northeast 14th Street is already overloaded with traffic going, as it is the only throughway going from 2nd Avenue to Federal Highway that you can turn from heading south on 2nd Avenue and go east. George Bush Boulevard prohibits turning east from 2nd Avenue if you are heading south on 2nd Avenue. So therefore, the only way to go east from 2nd Avenue to Federal Highway or to the Dixie Highway, where this is going to be located, would be to use 14th Street. 14th Street is already blocked up between the trains and the inability to go east on George Bush Boulevard, as well as the traffic bottleneck that exists due to the halfway house that prohibits any sort of drop-offs or deliveries in there on their property. So there are already delivery trucks like Amazon, UPS, and FedEx that park on 14th Street in front of our house, blocking our traffic. In addition, there are numerous late night activities going on at that corner because of all of the halfway houses and such and substance abuse treatment facility residences that exist there. There's loud noises. This is going to the noises that are going to come from this new facility are going to be exacerbated by that. In addition, We are concerned about the size and the height of the building. We are concerned about the egress and ingress. We're concerned about the sale or lack thereof of alcohol, which is going to also create more drama and disturbance on our street, as is the traffic that comes up and down Northeast 14th Street, shines into the bedroom windows of our house, our neighbors' homes, and such. We, you know, this location is not suitable for something that is going to have that much activity up to 11 p.m. at night on weekends. This is a residential neighborhood that abuts this, and it should be continue to be respected as that, and the residences should be the residents of that neighborhood should have that respect as well, which we've already lost to a certain degree due.
Zoltan Jorfi, living at 1010 Northeast 8th Ave, apartment 32F, Delray Beach, Florida, 33483. Leaving a comment on conditional use for Pop Stroke at 1314 North Federal Highway. I think it's a great idea. It'll be fun. It'll attract new business. 4,500 square foot restaurant. I have no issues with this. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Anthony Fasciani. I live at 727 South Lake Avenue and have lived in the Delray La Hacienda neighborhood for over 20 years. I'm calling about the proposed land use for Pop Stoke or Stroke at 1314 North Federal Highway. There have been many building improvements on Federal Highway, especially south of George Bush Boulevard. Federal Highway north of George Bush Boulevard feels like a forgotten part of Delray. There's even a sign thanking you for visiting Delray Beach, even though you're still in Delray until just before Gulfstream Boulevard. Myself and others in our community have always hoped for a better redevelopment along the north and south Federal Highway corridor. It's disappointing to find out that too many 18-hole golf courses, bar and restaurant, are being proposed for the land use at 1314 North Federal Highway. This project does not fit the small town feel of Delray Beach. I hope the commission reconsiders the land use. It would be nice to have a small plaza with restaurants, shops to benefit the surrounding communities and keep the small town feel rather than have a golf style amusement park at that location. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Renee Nowlin. I have been sworn in. I live at 713 South Lake Avenue in Delray Beach in La Hacienda. I adamantly oppose to the golf course and restaurant to be built on the land at 1314 North Federal Highway. We already have so much noise from traffic on Federal, and there are constant accidents at 14th Street and Federal. The last one being a couple of weeks ago, an SUV and a motorcycle. We love the dollar store. We visit there at least three times a week. I can't even imagine how crazy it would be with something like that put in there. So that is my testimony. Thank you so much. Bye.
Hello, this is Doreen Aker and Lance Aker. We live at 920 St. George Boulevard in the St. George townhomes. We're calling to vote against Pop Stroke to be potentially built at 1314 North Federal Highway. We feel as if it'll be too loud. There's a golf course just down the street. It's, you know, too much in a small place that won't fit with our family neighborhood. We already hear the train and can already hear other sounds and music. It would be very detrimental to not only our home value, but also our lives as we live here. We also believe that it will bring an influx of people into our neighborhood, and it is far, far too close for our liking. So both of us would like to vote against this. We think the hours are too late. It sounds too loud. We much would rather see something like a restaurant or something useful that Zalvery Beach does not have and is not so loud. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
And that's all the messages.
Thank you, Diane. Okay, seeing we've all heard public comment, we can move in. Mr. Cavelli, do you have any questions?
I don't have any questions.
Ms. Lasky? Hello?
I'm sorry.
Oh, somebody said they had a question. Well,
I don't have any questions, but I think there's some point in this I get to rebut this, right? The comments. Well,
that's what I was just about to say. I see Mr. Bennett came on here. I was going to ask you, do you have any questions or rebuttal to offer after the public testimony? Okay.
Yeah. Is this the appropriate time?
Please.
I would like to just address a few of the comments if I could.
Please.
You know, in terms of traffic, I understand there are some existing conditions that are not a result of this project. Understand that when the evaluation was done on this, that the traffic in the general area was evaluated in terms of design capacity. That doesn't mean that it's that you don't have to wait for a traffic light. It means that under the standards of Palm Beach County, that all of the roadways operate within the standard that's required. One of the things that I think is significant about this, it isn't an 8 o'clock in the morning peak hour. It's not a 5 o'clock in the afternoon peak hour, like the normal peak hour is for businesses. So while there is traffic generated by the project, it's not concurrent with the standard peak hours. So that's something that should really be taken into consideration with regards to traffic. With regards to access to the site, The site is very restricted in terms of it only has one entrance on Federal Highway, and it only has one entrance on Dixie Highway. The site is basically secured, except for the very north end of the site. So people can't walk across the railroad tracks and just filter into the project. It has controlled access, and the parking was purposely put at the north end of the site near the shopping center. So to control the any conflicts that might happen between pedestrians and cars, all the cars are kept to the north, all the pedestrians filter south into the project from there. So there was consideration given for safety. As far as hours, I think the code requires that the lights have to be shut off at 11 o'clock, even on the weekends. So while the intent is to have the restaurant open until midnight on the weekend, I believe the code requires that the lights have to be shut off on the outdoor area at 11 o'clock at night. So this isn't a really late night facility that's going till 2 o'clock in the morning. It's also if you look at the other facilities, it's really a family oriented type facility. It's a restaurant, as someone said, about a small town feel. the application says it's 4,500 square foot restaurant. That's because you calculated on the gross square footage. In reality, the kitchen is over 1,000 square feet. So this restaurant that's associated with this is really not that big. You know, if everyone's familiar with Racks downtown, that's a 3,000 square foot restaurant. It's not a big restaurant. So when you look at this, I don't know for a 3-acre site how much smaller you can really get in terms of the impact. The golf is an important aspect of this. It's outdoor recreation. It's quiet recreation. There is no Jumbotron. I know that in Fort Myers, they have a big screen, which is a scoreboard on the roof. We've had a lot of discussion with staff, and we're not going to be doing any big screens on the roof or anything like that. There will be a kiosk in the middle of the golf course that will have some like flat screen TVs that are scoreboards, but they're not big giant screens. So you don't have that. There will be nothing up on the roof to do that. In terms of landscaping, the code requires us to do shade trees around the perimeter of the property every 30 feet with trees that will have a approximately 20-foot spread ultimately. So, and there will be a fence and a hedge. So the project will be screened and secured from both the inside and outside, where you can't get in from outside, you can't get out from inside. So there it will be screening required. And in terms of the golf course itself, all the area between the actual putting greens will have landscaping. So there will be a lot of trees internal to this, because remember, in Florida, you need shade if you're going to be open during the day. So you'll find that the landscaping in this project will far exceed what is typical of a commercial development. With regards to the light and the noise issue, again, it's not a large restaurant. It's on 3 acres. The building was situated in an east-west manner so that the back of the building doesn't face any one place. The building is essentially open to the south. So any noise that may project is not going out of the building to the west or to the east. It will go basically to the south, where all of the trees that are in the buffers and the golf course will help to filter that noise. Also, we do have a noise ordinance that has to be complied with. So with regards to putting around, there was a lot of evaluation done and in consideration of that. And I appreciate the fact for the call from the owners, but we really felt like this is not in competition with putting around. It's a very different situation. It is truly a putting experience that may not be for certain people. It has outdoor play areas, which is a different venue. So I think that the two facilities could complement each other and not really be in competition with each other. If anyone has any questions, I'm happy to answer those.
Thank you, Mr. Cavalli. Ms. Slatsky, do you have any rebuttal or cross-examination?
Deb, I can hear you talking through the hall, but you're not talking on the meeting. Let me go check on Deb. Maybe she can come into my office.
No problem.
Can you hear me, board?
Yes, we can, Ms. Lasky. Oh,
okay. All right. Mr. Chair, I just wanted to answer to your question in reference to the, I think it's a townhouse development across the street on Federal Highway. Mm-hmm. If you can see my screen,
the St. George
subject site. Yeah, yes. They're over here, and it is the same zoning district. It is GC, and the code, the comprehensive plan, always asks and requires that we make special considerations when there is a change in intensity, as in this case, from general commercial to single family residential across the street over here. So that's one of the differences why we're not so focused on the St. George, but of course the board has the opportunity to bring that.
Of course, thank you.
So I think that answered your question, right?
Yes, it did, thank you.
At the time they had to get a conditional use to do residential there.
Perfect, perfect. Do you have any additional cross-examination or rebuttal for it. Mr. Covelli? That's
good.
It?
Thank you.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you, Ms. Lasky. Please stick around because I think other members of the board may have questions for you. We're going to head into board discussion right now. Great. Thank you, Mr. Covelli. Thank you, Ms. Lasky. I'll now turn it over to my colleagues on the board. Does anybody have any questions of the applicant?
I have a question.
Who's going to go first? Ms. Howell?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I just have a question, and maybe I missed it in your presentation, but given the comments from the neighbors about the concerns on lighting, I'm just wondering, I saw the height of the buildings is 20 feet, I believe, but what is the height of the lighting?
We haven't gotten there yet. We're thinking they will be LED lights that have cutoff shields on them so they don't spill out beyond the property line. It could be 16 to 20 feet, which is a standard. They're not way up in the air.
When you say that they're going to have cutoffs, will that protect from the lighting pollution going toward the east to the townhouses as well as the west?
Yes, it needs to be done so that 99% of the light stays within the site. So any lights along the perimeter will actually have shields on them so that the light goes inward, not outward.
And the vegetation, I heard what you said about the 20-foot spread, and I think it's great. It sounds like a great project in a lot of ways. The shade that you're going to provide, obviously you're not going to be able to just start with small trees. You're going to be doing mature trees. Is that right?
Yeah, in order to, especially internal to the site, we're not going to be planting, 10-foot trees because obviously that interferes with the golf play. So the trees will be of a much larger size when they're planted, yes.
What about the trees along the perimeter?
The perimeter will probably be a minimum of 16 feet when they're planted. It's a matter of, we haven't gotten that far yet in terms of species, but we do know that we have to have a tree and a buffer, especially along the federal highway. There are special landscape requirements for that buffer. But we do intend to have a hedge and trees all the way around the perimeter of the site.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Davey?
Thank you, Ms. Is that Ms. Blankenship?
It is.
I was looking for your hand, but I didn't see it.
I didn't want to confuse the situation.
Okay.
If I may.
The floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Mr. Covelli, if I'm understanding correctly, your testimony is that the Jumbotron leaderboard that's referenced both in the staff report and in the project narrative will not be on a rooftop or in any way on the outside of the building. Is that what I'm understanding you to have said?
The answer is there will be nothing on the roof. Define Jumbotron, I guess, is the next thing.
Okay, well, in the project narrative that was provided to us by you, on the, I believe it's the, maybe the third picture in the narrative, there is a picture of a Jumbotron or a screen or an LED screen of some sort that's on a rooftop.
That was a horrible mistake.
Project narrative.
That was a horrible mistake. Now, I will tell you that and I'm not making light of that. We were using images from some of these other facilities that are in different areas. And that is one of the things they do, but we have had many conversations about it and we have decided that obviously we know that the code won't let us do it on the roof. Then they talked about like a larger flat screen on the side of the building. And I think we're down to, if you can look at the plan that's on your screen right now, you'll see a little square in the middle of the golf course. We're talking about putting some flat screen TVs on the sides of that, which are interactive scoreboards that you use with your phone.
Okay, and any ideas on the height of those?
They probably won't be any more than 6 feet high, and they're not going to be huge because they can't be that big if they're not that far off the ground.
Okay, and then my concerns being, anything like that would be a distraction to motorists going by,
right.
You know, on Federal Highway or like a. So that would be my main concern as a public safety issue. So, are you willing to state on the record that is the plan as you see it today, that there will not be a Jumbotron screen on a rooftop, and that your plan right now today is to put it inside internally about 6 feet high, or you're not quite sure?
It's around that area, but yes, it won't be on the building.
Okay, so you'd be comfortable with that as a condition of the condition?
Sure.
And then my next concern would be the hours of operation. In my view, I know a lot of the businesses in the downtown area have an 11 p.m. would have a not as similar use as yours, but maybe have some outdoor activities going on adjacent to the residential neighborhood. I know there's an 11 p.m. Stop time for most of those. And considering that the outdoor lights would have to be shut off at 11 p.m., how would you feel about on Fridays and Saturday nights also? She's saying like that, you know, just closing at 11 p.m. on those nights.
Just and not to counteract what you just said, but as I understand the code, that the downtown businesses that are within, I think it's 300 feet of a residential area, have to close at midnight. And Amy or Deborah can correct me on that. And I believe the code says that we can be open till midnight, but the lights have to go off. Any outdoor activity lights have to go off at 11 o'clock. So the only thing that they would be doing is finishing up in the restaurant in that hour. That would be it for the weekend.
Okay. I'd like to hear what my colleagues have to say about that. I just have a question for staff as it relates. I don't know if Amy or Ms. Slatsky can help me. To this jumbo, or the LED screens that were going to be in the center of this golf course area, what part of the code would regulate that? Or is there a part of the code that would regulate that if that was the plan going forward by the applicant?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'll start, and I'm sure Amy can add to it. So in the LDR, there's a section that is specific to signage. It is 4.6.7
We would have to receive some type of proposal or sketch from the applicant for us to be able to determine if it would comply with the signage requirement or if it would just be something similar to just a TV in a sports bar.
And do TVs and sports bars, are they usually located outside? You see my concern. I'm just looking for wherever in the code, because it's my understanding if it's an LED type monitor or television, it would not be signage per se. And I'm just curious if the code would regulate it at all, if it would be like a new situation. Is the code silent? Does it speak to it?
I don't think it does.
I can't think of anything specific that would speak to this situation other than when we look at the elevations for the kiosk or also the photometric plan and the impacts from any, I guess, additional lighting from the screens. The sign code would kick in if the TVs, I guess, were visible from the public right away and were primarily being utilized for advertising or signage for the business. But otherwise, I think it would be the photometric plan and then also looking at the elevations. Some of the other restaurants that do have maybe screens outdoors, they're under covered patios. So they may not be walled, but they do have a roof and they're covered and they're typically more internal to the site. So this is kind of a new situation.
You see my concerns, of course. If it's something that's four-sided and it's above the fence line and there's nothing in the code that regulates how they can bring it forward, I'm concerned about what ultimately will show up there. As I stated previously, I would be, agreeable to some sort of a condition on the conditional use that limits the screens that are proposed on this site plan to a height certain, but I'm looking for direction from staff or from the city attorney how that would look sound, and then of course input from my colleagues on that. That's all the comments I have at this moment, and I look forward to hearing what everyone else has to say.
Thank you, Ms. Blankenship.
Mr. Chairman, Max Weinberg.
Mr. Weinberg.
Yes, hello all. I have a couple of questions, and to Ms. Blankenship's point regarding the TV monitor, scoreboard, however you identify it. Mr. Covelli, is it visible from any part of Federal Highway or Dixie?
Well, the goal is to have a fence and a hedge around the perimeter of the property. And with that, you most likely will not be able to see in once the hedge matures. It'll be maintained at around the 6-foot height. Something just came to mind that what we could do, we could actually mount them inside the fence facing inward, and you could put one at the south end and one at the west end and one at the east end, where the backs of those screens would be up against the fence and the screen. And then you certainly would not see those from the street rather than do it on a kiosk. So either way, we could do that.
The screens are for the benefit of the players.
Yes, it's basically a digital scoreboard. And when you play, you have your name, and it just has your score for the course that you're playing.
And how many are there?
There's two 18-hole courses.
No. How many screens?
Well, what I just said, we could do three if we put them out against the fences. One at the south, one at the east, one at the west.
Right. In other words, so the backs of these screens would be facing the roadway.
Yes.
And most likely, the front of the screen that's facing east, west, or south, because of the screenage, the landscaping, you're saying would not be visible from the road.
You would have to look for the one that would have its back on Federal Highway say. You would have to look all the way across the site from Dixie Highway to try to see that. And remember, there's a lot of landscaping within the golf course itself too. So not only are you looking through the perimeter screening, you're also looking through all of the landscaping internal to the site. Chances are you're not going to get a glimpse of that if you get it that way.
I would be more concerned with vehicular traffic, you know, driving and suddenly getting a glimpse of a scoreboard. Or moving away from that, was any thought given to, so on the west side, you do have the neighborhood. On the other side of the railroad tracks there, it seems to me that some sort of highway, and we're all familiar with the highway, they're not fences, they're high walls, would completely screen that neighborhood. Almost if you had a batting cage that instead of netting wouldn't be this high, but would be a self-enclosed wall around it. And the reason I ask that is the facility as much a standalone restaurant as it is a putting green? And are there, and this goes to also to that point, are there tiered levels of admission? Can you go to the restaurant without playing golf? Can you play golf without going to the restaurant? It seems like there's, in fact, in the narrative, it does say that it's sort of a little bit for everyone. And I wonder if the alcohol component comports with the, it's great for the adults, the potential. I don't know how this business works in its other locations. The district there is not it's certainly blighted, excuse me, but it's not an entertainment area. It's not to say it couldn't be, but I'm a little confused as to what the primary business is. Is it a putting green or is it, a restaurant at whatever size, 3,500 or 4,500 square feet?
Yeah.
Certainly it's not a big building, but.
No.
Yeah.
What I can tell you is the way this functions is kind of, it's something for everyone. And so, the goal is that you bring your family. There's a playground with slides. There's an open game area that has cornhole and ping pong and foosball and all those kinds of things. There's a golf shop with an ice cream shop in it. There's a restaurant that actually serves alcohol. Yes, it does. And there is the golf. Can someone come just to eat there? Yes, they can. Can someone come just to play golf? Yes, they can. Generally, if you're going to make the trip as this being a destination, you're probably going to spend time and do everything.
So it is a bit like a small amusement park. Can you bring alcohol out of the restaurant into the putting greens?
I believe you can, but I'm not 100% sure. I think they will serve you there.
They will serve you. So, and is there a capacity limit?
I really don't know.
In other words, I don't mean alcoholic capacity, but the capacity of patrons at any one time. And you certainly have a lot of parking, but
yes, they have to control how many people are on the course, and that's all done digitally. That's part of the scoreboard, also. But you would check in at the golf shop, and they would stage people. The restaurant also has a very large open air staging area out on the parking lot side, so that they can control how many people are in here. Obviously, they have to do that because of the COVID rules and things like that. So this is truly set up to control the number of people that are within the venue.
It does control the, just the setup alone controls yes. the amount of people that can be there at one time.
Yes.
I'm out of town. I pass this way every day. This is slightly north of the chocolate store?
Directly north of the chocolate factory.
Directly north. Okay, yes. So it's the big open property that had cars parked on it.
Correct.
Again, back to the wall idea, screening, some sort of, with that many people, the potential, and I'm not sure whether this is in our purview, but the potential at a small amusement park, I think the concept is great. The concerns of the neighborhood seem to be so concerned with the noise level, potential noise level. You never know until you build it. Mm-hmm. But if you're open till midnight in a non-entertainment area, sort of the downtown area would be that, and the lights are out on the golf course, then you're strictly related to a late night scene in the restaurant. And that's about it, I guess.
And if you had a floor plan of this, you would see that the western portion of the building, which is about a quarter of the building maybe, is the kitchen location. So the whole western end of this building is solid. It's not open. It's where all the freezers and refrigerators and kitchen prep area are. So, and the area to the east is the golf shop and the golf shop and the ice cream area. So the main part of this building is really in the dead center of the property, with the open portion of it really more towards the south, because the north is out on the parking lot and the building is connected to the golf shop and the ice cream to the east. So we've tried to situate the building to control the area where the openness faces, taking into consideration any kind of noise levels that might project from the building.
Yeah. Has any study been done by the company to determine what other restaurants along that strip? I'm thinking of the 50s diner up the road. What time they close?
I'm not aware. We have not looked at that.
Yeah. And the last question about the lighting on the golf course. You said 16 to 20 feet high. As the participants are human scale, would it be sufficient to go up 8 feet? Or do you get a general sort of illumination like a runway?
Well, just remember, you know, you do have minimum lighting requirements for public areas, and the light fixtures are made to project mm-hmm. the light down. The lower the pole, the more poles you need. So, you know, it's a balancing act where, you know, I'm not sure that you're really achieving that much, because as the light comes down, it fades towards the outside of the cone that it projects. So when you have to have lower poles with more lights, I'm not sure you get that much fade. So the result may be it may be brighter. There's really good LED fixtures that have a lot of more control of where the light goes now, versus the old halogen lights or the old sodium vapor lights. We feel confident that we can keep the light spill under control from the property.
Okay, that's all I have. Thank you for answering my questions, sir.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Weinberg. Excuse me, Mr. Zeller?
Yes, I have some questions.
Please, feel free, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. is there going to be a PA system out there on the golf course?
Not that I'm aware of.
Would you agree to a condition that there not be a PA system?
I believe the system is, and this is part of the scoreboards where it's all digital and runs through your phone. And so my understanding of the way it works, it's all like interactive with your phone. So as far as I'm aware, that I've never heard any discussion about a PA system.
Okay. Is there any type of music that's being played out there on the golf course?
I am not aware if there is or isn't. I'm sorry, I don't know that.
Would the applicant agree to a condition that there not be music played out there on the golf course?
I haven't discussed that with the owner, so I'm not sure. I can try to find out between now and while other people talk.
Okay, so here are some of my concerns in addition to what have been the okay. concerns that have been expressed by the other board members, which and the residents in particular, which relate to the lighting and to the noise and to the landscaping and to the screening. Since you're asking us to approve this conditional use and we have to show that the beneficial aspects of this project outweigh the negative impacts and any points of conflict, and we know that there's the large residential community to the west. There's no buffering whatsoever except a couple of patches of trees and bushes along the railroad tracks on either side of the railroad tracks. So there's no existing buffering. So we're left with the buffering that you say you're going to propose or put in. But you haven't shown us a landscaping plan. You haven't shown us a lighting plan, but you're asking us to just give you this approval and then hope that the lighting plan gets approved by SPRAB or the landscaping plan. I don't understand why you wouldn't give us a lighting plan and a landscaping plan.
Mr. Zeller,
do it
excuse
like
me.
A traffic study.
Mr. Zeller?
Yes.
I just want to tell you that applicants at this point, when they're coming in, you know, a long time on this board, when people are coming in for conditional use, give us a plan and all these other things at this time. So I don't think that it's fair to hold that against the applicant. You know, he's really here, and if we want to put restrictions on it, and as a majority of the board who feels like they want to put restrictions on it, that's within our purview. But I don't know that it's necessarily proper for us to hold against the applicant that they haven't brought a lighting plan this evening. So
I understand, but they're asking for relief from these concerns that are expressed by the surrounding neighbors, the lighting. We have no idea that the lighting won't spill over into the neighborhood. Here, I have a couple other questions. So how long does it take to play a round of golf?
In terms of putting?
If I wanted to play 18 holes of golf there.
You could probably do it in less than an hour or so.
Okay. So if somebody came in and said, I want to play golf at 10:30 at night, would they get thrown off the course at 11 o'clock when the lights go
black at 11 o'clock?
They would most likely be told that either they can't play or they would have to be done by 11.
Okay. And the other thing that I didn't really get to understand, but I suppose this is strictly putting. There's no pitching. There's no chipping. Is that right?
Correct. Just putting. The course is just putting greens. There are no obstacles or bridges or windmills or anything like that. It's just putting greens on grass.
So if they hit the ball into one of those sand traps, they just put it back on the green and continue putting away. Is that how it works?
I'm sorry, say it again.
I said, so if they were to hit the ball into one of those sand traps along the side of the putting green, they mm-hmm. just pick it up and they put it back on the green.
Yeah, I mean, nobody's going to be chipping out of the sand trap, no.
Okay. And the... You said that's going to be serving of liquor onto the golf course. Is that right?
I believe so, yes.
Uh-huh. We don't know how high those light standards are going to be, but there are going to be light standards surrounding the perimeter of this. Is that how it's going to work?
There will be lights within the project. You know, there will be lights that light the parking lot. That's city code. There will be lights to light the facility. All of those lights are regulated by code in terms of the lumens and light cannot spill off the site. That's strictly a code compliance approval that we're required to give a photometric plan when we go for site plan approval.
Okay. So the proposed landscaping around the perimeter of the golf course, is that intended to be a total screen to prevent or create a shield, a noise shield and a light shield from spilling over or off of the golf course?
There will be trees, shade trees all around the perimeter of the project with a hedge and a fence.
Okay, and so what type of fence are you proposing?
Usually it's some kind of a decorative fence, that the hedge material basically grows, you know, along the fence. So the main screening is the hedge material.
I didn't hear you.
The main screening is provided by the hedge material.
Okay. But is the fence a solid fence or is it going to be open?
In some areas they have installed picket fences for security, and then the hedge material fills in between the pickets.
Okay, so it'll be an open fence. I mean, the fence is not going to be solid. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, it's a security fence.
The chain link fence?
No chain link. Absolutely not.
Okay. Can somebody hit a ball through that fence?
Again, there will be a heavy landscape hedge in addition to that fence. And everyone has putters. I'm not sure who's driving balls.
Okay. And as was commented before, I'm I'm concerned about the restrictions on this Jumbotron, since
there is no Jumbotron on the roof.
Okay, well, I understand you say it's not on the roof. I don't care where it is. That's another source of light pollution that'll spill over into the residence.
I'm sorry?
I said the Jumbotron is another source of light spillage.
There's no Jumbotron.
You say there's no Jumbotron on the roof.
No.
Mr. Zeller.
We need to go through the Jumbotron conversation again. We've done this. No offense.
Excuse me. Mr. Long? You weren't recognized. Respectful. Mr. Zeller. Mr. Cavelli, at the beginning of the presentation, said there will be no Jumbotrons. That was something they've done in other locations. And he also represented that the TVs, which hand the score, would either be mounted in the center of the golf course at a level of 6 feet or below, or in the questioning and discussion with Mr. Weinberg, the applicant said that another possibility would be to mount the TVs on the east, west, and south on the fence, so that the backs of the TVs would be facing the roadways and the TVs would then be facing internally to the site. So he represented there is not going to be a Jumbotron. So I don't know if you have any other questions regarding the TVs. Please go ahead.
No, but I do have a question. With all these other suggestions that were made by the board members, which I believe are very valid, to mitigate against the negative impacts that the residents testified against, that they be imposed as formal conditions if this application is approved. And I'm asking the applicant as to whether they will consent to having them imposed as condition.
I actually have information that I can't answer your one question. There are no PA systems within the project.
Okay.
And they do have music piped in through the golf course. Not loud, but it's piped in through the golf course. They have it on 12 facilities and have not had an issue for doing so.
And that music will be on till 11 o'clock at night.
Just like the other places in town do. I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Chair, if I may.
Please go ahead.
All good, thank you. So I don't actually have any questions. The benefit of going last is my fellow board members, I'm asked a lot of great questions, but I do have a few comments. Just in general, it seems like the applicant has very well thought out and is very amenable to figuring out ways to help buffer this project, this site, from the surrounding neighborhoods, whether it be with the lighting or with landscaping, et cetera. And my big concern actually was the Jumbotron issue as well, but I mean, I feel like the concept of putting the screens on the fences and keeping them at like 6 feet pretty adequately addresses that. And just, you know, looking at this project, as I mentioned earlier, I checked it out on the website, looked at some pictures of some of the existing ones, as I'm sure many of my fellow board members did the same. But I picture it less than like a traditional mini golf course, as we saw in the video. Like, there's not like windmills and pirate ships and King Kong and stuff like that. It's legitimately looks like a small scale golf course,
right,
with a fairly modest restaurant. And I mean, frankly, that's a different dynamic than I think what a lot of the community surrounding seem to be concerned about. Not that I don't respect their concerns, because I do, but I feel like a lot of it may have been based on some misconceptions about what this project actually is, given that putting around even supports it because it's so different than a traditional mini golf course, I find interesting. And I think that it kind of showcases what a sophisticated and state-of-the-art sort of thing that this is. To me, I mean, the other thing I want to just throw out there is I understand the concerns over noise pollution, but this isn't exactly a quiet area. It's next to train tracks and a highway. I mean, do we really think there's going to be that much additional noise from folks on a pretty spread out putting green that's going to really, and some music going until 11? I don't think they're going to be blasting it. I think it'll probably be loud enough that folks can hear it in that general area, and it's going to be buffered by landscaping as well. I just don't see a lot of music really spilling over and affecting the neighborhood that badly. Just from, you know, what I'm seeing now. And also regarding the lighting, it seems like they've taken precautions to make sure there's not a lot of light spillage. And I mean, I'm willing to give the applicant the benefit of the doubt that they're operating in good faith in regards to actually doing these buffers. And if not, that the rest of the site plan review process will catch any issues. Right. So I mean, that all being said, I think this is something that this area actually could benefit from. It is a blighted area. And I do appreciate the traffic concerns, but I think the applicant made a great point about the peak times here, the traffic's gonna be coming in and out, not being at, you know, standard peak times on Federal. So maybe it's not gonna be as much of a concern as residents may have anticipated. So that being said, I am in support of this project. I think it would be a great thing to add to Delray Beach. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Long. At any rate, I guess now it's my turn. I'd say I came into this evening having a lot of concerns. Belly has allayed many of them. I guess my first question I want to direct to Ms. Slasky. Ms. Slasky, is there a limit on the fencing in this area that it would have to be only to a maximum of 6 feet? Ms. Slasky, I think you're still muted.
I have to unmute myself in two different places, and this is mute.
No problem.
So the code does require fencing to have a maximum height of 6 feet along the side street and front. So the only side that they could have 8 feet is between, it's adjacent to the shopping plaza to the north.
Right. Okay. No, because to be quite frank with you, if the landscaped hedge, let's say, if we can't go with a fence, but if the landscaped hedge on this property was to be really landscaped in to a height of 8 feet, I'd feel a lot better about the situation, because my concerns regarding the lighting have been somewhat allayed. And the spillover effect to the residential neighborhood to the west. It is only 150 feet away. What I'm more concerned about, though, is the spillover effect of sound, okay? I know, listen, this golf course is gonna be on Federal Highway. You know, I'm sure they're gonna have the music set at a good level. And you know, it's going to be on till 11 o'clock at night, and 150 feet away is an R1 zone. You know, that's single family residential. So that's really my concern, and it would be allayed to a better degree if I felt that the hedging was going to be allowed to mature to a greater extent and be more extensive on the perimeter of the property. And I have to tell you that my colleagues on the board, Ms. Blankenship, especially was the first one to note it, I hadn't even thought of the visualization of drivers on southbound Federal Highway or on Dixie Highway looking and being distracted by something on the site. But, you know, if they were to take the landscaping and make it lab, that would also eliminate any situation of any passing driver being able to see something, whether it's on a TV screen or anywhere else in the site. So I don't know, Mr. Gavelli. First, let me ask you, Ms. Slatsky, is that something that would be allowed?
Willen, if you can help me with that.
If the landscaping hedges around the property, if the fence could only go to 6 feet, but can the landscaped hedges go higher than that?
Is that
Mr. Gavelli, please, I see you with your hand raised.
If I may.
Please.
I know that on Federal Highway, we could, while Deborah's looking at the height of the hedge, we could actually build a 2-foot berm. We do have room on the Federal Highway side to actually build a 2-foot berm that we could then put the 6-foot fence and hedge on top of the berm. So that would take care of the federal highway frontage, which I think is the main concern there.
It's my main concern there, but it's also the buffer to the residential neighborhood.
But at least that could easily address that without having to do anything special with the hedge. And then along the south side, I don't really see any reason why it needs to be more than 6 feet along the south side because it's adjacent to the road and then the chocolate factory. Along the west side, we could do like a clusia hedge or something like that you could maintain to 8 feet, provided that the code will let us do so.
Okay, well, that's something if the applicant would be amenable to it as a condition. I want to approve this project, but at the same point in time, I want to see that the impact to the residential neighborhood is as minimal as possible.
Agreed.
And the other condition I want to say was regarding Ms. Blankenship's comments on the project regarding the closing time, et cetera. I hope you'll really take that into consideration.
Deborah has the code section up here, and I may, and Deborah, I'll ask you for or even the city attorney for clarification on this. I do see that not continue after 11 p.m., but I was reading on saying, or 1 hour after that used to finish up. I don't know if that applies in this case or not. I would like to have someone. I do see no outdoor recreational facility be illuminated after 11 p.m. So I agree with that part. But I'm not sure about that section where it gives you the extra hour to finish up after 11.
I think Ms. Lasky highlighted the applicable area if you look on your screen.
And that's it with regards to the illumination. But above the next in that area, it talks about they should not continue after 11 p.m. or more than 1 hour after active use of the area ceases. So I'm not sure what that means.
If I may, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, we can.
So for this, this site has two principal uses that are being proposed in front of you. One being the recreational miniature golf course and the other one being the restaurant. Those are two allowed uses in the GC General Commercial Zoning District. The recreational facility would be restricted to the lighting being up to 11 o'clock.
Agreed.
The restaurant portion of the use could be would be limited to this first section of the code. So the 11 o'clock or more than 1 hour after active use of the area ceases. So
So if the restaurant stops operation at 11, then lighting would have to be turned off by 1 a.m.
Wouldn't that be 1 hour? It would be midnight, wouldn't it?
Midnight.
Not 1 a.m.
If it is at 11, but they're proposing to stop, I believe it's Thursday, Friday, Saturday. They're proposing to stop at 12.
The restaurant would close at midnight. Oh, I see what you're saying.
Blankenship. Right. What I'm saying is I think Ms. Blankenship had asked if you would close at 11 on those nights too. Is that correct, Ms. Blankenship?
Yes, it is. Thank you.
Okay. So, Mr. Cavalli, I think that, you know, if you'll abide by a couple of conditions here tonight, you can get out of here with probably a good deal of support.
The only thing that I will tell you that 1 hour on the weekends for the restaurant is devastating. And you know, downtown, everyone's open until midnight and 2 o'clock in the morning.
The downtown area, with all due respect.
This isn't
downtown. This is not the downtown.
This is not downtown.
I get that. But so, I will tell you that is.
I just would like one part clarification from Ms. Lasky, just to make sure I heard her correctly. Because the restaurant is being proposed to close at 12, then the lighting in the parking lot and other areas would be allowed to be on until 1 a.m. Is that what I'm understanding?
That's correct.
See, I can't do that. I would still hold for and that it would be 11 p.m. I know restaurant stop time, which would be midnight, I guess.
So just one thing.
Mr. Bennett.
Don't think that the board can limit the hours of the restaurant, because the restaurant's not a conditional use.
Right.
It's just the golf course. So if the board wanted to limit the operational hours under 245E for the conditional uses, I think it can do that, because that's the conditional use you're approving. If Mr. Cavalli's client wanted just to open up a restaurant, he would not be before the board seeking permission to do that. So I think the restaurant, he can operate it under the code and whatever those hours are permissible. But the board could consider, you know, the golf aspect of this location having the hours limit.
Mr. Bennett, let me ask you, if that's the case and it passes, it gets approved through planning and zoning this evening and goes ahead to city commission, would the commission be able to impose hours on that or not?
I don't believe so, because, and just like when we have, you know, like a convenience mart, you guys aren't approving the condition of selling of food items at a gas station. You're just approving the ability for them to provide gasoline at that location. So I think we've got two uses, only one of which is really before you, which is the use as an outdoor recreational golf course.
Okay, so let's say all that happened, approved, and they come for site plan. Now, could that be addressed at site? Or
I would want to take a closer look at the LDRs, and then also with staff. I'm not certain that they might be able to, but I don't know that for certain, so I don't want to say yes.
Okay. Fair enough. Thank you.
Can I ask you something? Mr. Bennett, I just want to ask you something, and then I'm going to recognize Ms. Howell. I see she has her hand up. Mr. Bennett, I just wanted to ask you, would we be allowed to limit no outdoor amplified music be outside after 11 o'clock?
Well, again, that would be tied solely to the recreational golf course.
Right, not to the restaurant. We have no right to for the restaurant.
Right, so if the restaurant or those, you know, the outdoor area with the cornhole or things like that, you know, if they had music or TVs or ambient noise, that wouldn't be something that could be limited through this process.
Okay, and can I ask you one last question? If we were, can we limit the conditional use to just the area of the site where they're at? So in other words, if another applicant, because I understand everything runs with the land, another applicant has the property 10 years from now and they want to do something, there's only a portion of this has been granted the conditional use, not the entire site.
So,
can I jump in on that one, William?
Yeah, don't mind. Towards no, I'm processing it in my head, but Amy, go ahead and maybe you'll help me process on that.
Well, you're reviewing a conditional use for the site, yes, but it has certain limitations that have been submitted by the applicant. So if the use area were to be expanded, that would be a conditional use modification, or it could be determined by the board to be a new conditional use, if I understood your question correctly.
If this
conditional use is not established, it does not run with the land, it's project specific, and a new one would come in also. So there's those two different components.
Thank you, Amy. No, I really appreciate that. Thank you. Ms. Howell.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a couple points of clarification. We've spent a lot of time really getting into the noise and light concerns on the actual golf portion of the site. I just want to ask Mr. Covelli, what percent of trees for buffers will be on the golf and restaurant portion versus the parking lot portion?
I can't really give you the percentage, but I will tell you that if you look at the site plan that's in your packet, you'll see that in addition to the landscaping that's on the Dixie Highway and the Federal Highway side, that there are large landscape islands between the parking spaces in every row of parking. Shade trees have to go in the islands on the ends of those. And again, with a spacing, trees also go in the north-south islands that are between the cars facing each other. So again, once again, all of that is regulated by code. And those are all shade trees that have to be planted in those landscape islands.
And the lighting that'll be in the parking lot, is it going to have the same, what do you call them again?
The cutoff light fixtures.
Cutoff light fixtures. Thank you.
And also, you know, again, the illumination of that parking lot is strictly regulated by code in terms of what the lighting requirement is.
Okay, and just the last thing, the miniature golf course putting around to the north of you, they've done a nice job just on signage and making it fit into the charm of Del Rey. Personally, this isn't a criteria, but I find your sign to be pretty commercial looking. I understand it's in a commercially zoned area, but I wonder if your client would consider perhaps adapting it to the Village by the Sea motif that we'd like to see tastefully done even on commercial properties.
I'll defer to staff, but I don't believe we're allowed to have pylon signs. So we would actually have to have a lower sign than a sign on a big pole like that.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I have a couple of follow-up questions based on this colloquy.
Sure, Mr. Zeller, please go ahead.
Okay, so here's what I'm troubled by. We know you're saying, yes, you're gonna have landscaping, yes, this is what the lighting is gonna be, and I'll do that at a later time. But it seems to me that the golf is an integral part of the entire use that you're presenting here, with the restaurant, with the play area, with the recreational and everything else. So I don't understand how or why we need to bifurcate those conditions that apply only to the conditional use portion of the site when we're looking at the entirety of the site to give the approvals. And that's one of the reasons why I think at this point, what we need to do is to either table this application and have them come back with more specific answers to address all of these conditions that have been raised by the board and by the residents that are valid conditions, and come back with you don't want to give us it may be that you don't have to give us a light plan or a landscaping plan, but I think it's in your interest to go a little beyond what you are required to do to allow us to feel comfortable that these concerns, all of these concerns that have been raised, are being mitigated on, even if we just limit it to the conditional use part, because there are clearly negative impacts that make this conditional use inconsistent with the LDRs and inconsistent with the comp plan. So if you're presenting it as a comprehensive package, then we should be able to have a way of giving a comprehensive approval, which we're not able to have right now based on all of the questions been raised by the board and by the majority of residents. So that's what my concern is right now, and I don't think that these concerns have been answered. I think you can answer them. I think that the project is you know, something that is a positive thing in the redevelopment of this area of Federal Highway or other of the city as well. But just need some comfort that we're not giving you a blank check to go forward with this application without getting any answers.
Zeller. So we've heard from all the members of the board. Let's now, we've hit the point where we've had our questions of the applicant. Do we want, I'd like to move us into board discussion if everybody is ready to do so. Anybody have anything?
I'm ready to make a motion.
Does anybody have a comment? Ms. Blankenship, please.
Thank you, Mr. Davey. Move a recommendation of approval with conditions to the City Commission for a conditional use request 2021-088 for Pop Stroke to allow a recreational establishment as a miniature golf containing two 18-hole courses on the property located at 1314 North Federal Highway by finding that the request is consistent with a comprehensive plan and meets the criteria set forth in the land development regulations, with the conditions as follows: that the leaderboard, jumbotron, screen signage, whatever you want to call it, represented by the applicant in his testimony, be placed along the line, not to be above the fence, with the back facing the fence. Also a 6 foot, well, I'm sorry, Mr. Was an 8 foot hedge buffer, as represented by the applicant in his testimony. And I don't know, did you want to include the berm as well?
Yeah.
So if I could,
yes,
maybe first, Mr. Cavalli.
Okay, go ahead.
One thing I would be concerned with such a level of specificity is if for some reason that becomes non-compliant with code, or SPRAB decides that whatever berm has been suggested is not, you know, appropriate, then they would almost have to come back to you to modify the conditional use
conditions in order to go back to SPRAB to change it in a manner that they think best meets the LDRs.
What's your recommendation, Mr. Bennett?
So I've jotted a couple notes. I think the two areas that there's consensus are limitation on the outdoor electronic displays, and then also fencing and landscaping around the east and west property lines, specifically towards those residential areas. So I think some language that I might recommend is just maximizing the fencing and landscaping on the east and west property lines facing the residential areas. Because that way SPRAB can determine, have they maximized that, there's enough there that they can use your guidance and your limitations on the conditional use to do that. I also was a little less specific on the outdoor electronic displays, to just say, in essence, to a size, height, and location which would not be visible from any adjacent right-of-way, and which be shielded in such a manner as to limit the addition of light pollution, and to add those on the photometric plan if you needed to. But I don't think the TVs make enough light to be on a photometric plan, but that limitation in size, height, and location so it's not visible from adjacent right-of-ways, I think, captures what you were trying to say earlier.
So eloquently stated by Mr. Bennett, the conditions, and also the condition that the restaurant to be, are we allowed the condition till 11 p.m. or you said no, the hours?
No, the restaurant is not part of the conditional use, so I think it'd be appropriate to include it as any conditions on the restaurant.
Okay, so my motion stands. Thank you.
Second.
I think we lost Mr. Davey.
Thank you. Thank you, Chip. Do we have a second on your motion?
Mr. Long, I believe you seconded the motion.
Yes, I did.
Diane, can you please call the roll?
Max Weinberg.
Did somebody have him muted?
I don't see Max listed as a panelist at the moment. He must have gotten disconnected.
He is in the lobby as an attendee, though.
Hold on. Mr. Weinberg.
Oh, I did see him.
Okay. Hold on.
Max, are you there now?
Is he there now? Are you there now?
Remote the other one. Boom. And see if that works.
His name is on the screen.
Well, we had two. He's connected twice. So if the name will promote the other Max Weinberg.
Hold on. Somebody's getting promoted.
I don't think it's letting me.
Here, Max. You should be coming up.
Both of them. It's not letting me do both of them.
Hello? Max, you should be. Hold on.
Then can you demote one and bring the other one up and switch them out?
They're trying to demote one of you. There's two of you plugged in. One's an attendee, and they're trying to demote you or promote you. I don't know, but they're trying to get you back, okay?
Just
hold up. Unmute, you got it.
Unmute Max. It's in the attendee list.
Okay, let's try this one.
Did they get you unmuted?
We're still working on it.
It won't let me make him a panelist.
Can you try just unmuting him and see if he's connected then? Max, can you try to talk?
Hello? Still muted, he's saying. Try connecting again. Oh, he can see us and hear us.
And it won't let you
promote. I don't know. Can you call IT or can they call you?
Diane, it's Hold on. Let's see.
You're okay. Perfect. We can hear him now, I think.
Max, are you there?
Believe me, I'm the last person somebody should be calling in this situation. Take my word on it.
He's unmuted. He should be able to talk to us now.
Ms. Kleinberg?
I can see him.
But I don't see a green microphone or a red one next to him.
Hello.
Yeah.
Mr. Weinberg. Oh, yawning. Not even 9 o'clock. Sorry, Joy.
That's okay. You outed me, Chris.
A rough crew.
Hello. Oh, I hear Max.
Can I be heard?
Yes.
Can anyone hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
You can. Max.
Yes. I can
yes.
sort of hear you all. I don't want to interrupt, but I can vote if you like.
Yes.
I haven't heard any of the preceding 10 minutes. If we're a little out of order, I realize that, and sorry for that, but I would vote for a recommendation of approval with those conditions.
Okay, thank you.
And Max, just to make sure you said that.
Please, Diane, continue with the roll.
Just briefly, Diane, hold on. Max, you said that you missed some of it, but you heard the two conditions were to maximize landscaping and fencing on the east and west, and to limit open electronic displays so that they're not visible from the right of way.
Correct, I heard that.
All right, perfect. Thank you. Go ahead, Diane.
Helen Zeller. Helen, can you hear us?
I'm not here to vote to approve. They said that there would be no PA system outside in the recreational area as a condition.
Mr. Zeller.
That's I want the record to reflect my reasons.
We don't work that way. Unfortunately, the meetings aren't run that way. I would love it if you could, but that's not the way the meetings are run according to Robert's rules.
Well, that's a no, then I'll vote no.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Zeller.
Julian Blankenship?
Yes.
Joy Howell?
Yes.
Rob Long?
Yes.
Chris Davey?
Yes. Thank you very much, Ms. Miller. Thank you. And we can move on to our last and final item of the evening.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Mr. Gavelli. Good luck. And hope your applicant has no problem abiding by the conditions, and we get another great project in town. Thank you.
We will agree to those conditions. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right.
With that being said, we can move on to item number 9A, the official zoning map by Ms. Alvarez.
Hi there. Deb, can you please share the ball with me? And then I am going to attempt to remember how to share my screen. Thank you. Okay, so this next item is the official zoning map. This is an ordinance number 1321. And my mouse stopped working. Okay, so our official zoning map was last adopted in 2017, and prior to then, it was last adopted in 1993. And the reason that we officially adopt the zoning maps is when we have a significant change in it, As you can see, in 2017, the city at that time was able to upgrade its mapping capabilities and use GIS for its maps. And at time, there were just corrections to polylines along I-95, colors of the overlay and historic districts, and text configurations and other edits and updates. So the proposed changes, as you can see, is that we're now using the land-based classification standards, and those help to, the color coding helps to identify locations of the use categories spread throughout the city. So you can see all of the yellow on there is primarily single family residential zoning districts. All of the purple are mixed use districts. So you see CBD, the downtown area, a bit easier on the map. Along Congress, just west of I-95, you see the MROC district. So it helps to just visualize the breakdown of all of the zoning districts throughout the city. We've also added the municipal planning area boundary, which is, the planning area is different from our actual municipal city limits. We've updated and better organized the key just to help color code and explain which zoning districts go with which color category, and then change some of the hatching patterns for the overlay districts. And you can see the historic districts are still recognized and identified on the map as well. And this is just a detail, again, of the key explaining the color coding with all of the zoning districts. And I'm sorry, that map is blurry. It was not blurry when I tested this earlier. So the LDRs, as far as the official zoning map, we're always changing the zoning map when we adopt rezoning ordinances. And so that does change the map. But this, again, is goes under other matter portrayed on the official zoning map. So just to note, all changes to the zoning district boundaries, the municipal city limits, planning area, none of that is changing from anything that has been previously approved. That is not part of this map, and this is not the proper process to do that anyways, and I need my job. So the changes classified are, again, other matter portrayed on the map. So your options are recommend approval, approval as amended if you see any tweaks you think we should make, or of course recommend denial, which we hope you don't do because we are really excited about the new map. So just, I guess, if you have any questions.
Ms. Alvarez, just thank you so much for moving forward on this and getting this in conformance with our comp plan update. Is there any timetable for any of the LDRs going forward that we need to revise in order to implement that comp plan?
There is a timetable that is in the comp plan. Anytime there's a policy that is a specific action item, the goal is completed by and whatever year that is. And those were, I forget how we termed them, but, you know, it was 2025 and we had different years identified with all of those action items. But right now, no, we've had the setback of the last year and just some other things happening. But I don't have anything other than that right now. There's a lot of action items that we would love to get to, but they also cost money.
Yeah, okay. I understand from a previous meeting before the commission, I think Mr. Poppy said that there is a list somewhere that you have. I wonder if you could share that with the Planning and Zoning Commission.
Sure, we can share that list. What the list does, that I believe you're referring to, it basically takes all of the projects or action items out of the comp plan and list them specifically by element and by time that is designated.
Oh, great.
Right.
Great. That'd be really helpful. It would just give us a roadmap. We kind of know what to expect coming down the road, which nights it is that we're going to be getting dinner at midnight. Thank you.
Hi.
I'll make a motion. I don't know. I think maybe we lost Mr. Davey. Oh, hi.
No, I'm here. I'm here. Go ahead, Ms. Blankenship. No, I was laughing. I'm like, I heard something about being at midnight.
No, I'm trying to avoid them. Amy, can you put it up on the screen? The motion on the screen.
Oh, yes. I'm sorry. Sure. There you go.
Thank you. Motion to recommend approval to the City Commission on Ordinance Number 13-21, adoption of the official zoning map of the City of Delray Beach.
Second.
Second by Ms. Howell. Ms. Miller, please call the roll.
You're on mute, Diane.
Diane.
Max Weinberg.
I think we lost him. We've got a quorum.
We lost him again. Happens when you promote someone.
There he is.
Max, can you hear us?
Max? Max?
Can you unmute it, Diane?
Max?
Yes.
Max?
I do hear you. I'm here.
Oh. Great. We have a motion on the floor to approve the zoning map. Motion by Julin, second by Ms. Howell.
Yes, and I approve that as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Weinberg.
Well done, everyone. I heard everything, and you just couldn't hear me.
Alan Zeller?
Yes.
Julin Blankenship?
Yes.
Joy Howell?
Yes.
Rob Long?
Yes.
Chris Davis.
Yes. Great. Well, thank you. That can majority of our agenda for the evening. We can now hear from Ms. Alvarez.
I just want to say thank you. And our next meeting is April 19th. And I think we have a 5-week span here. So enjoy that extra break that we've got this month. Since tonight was so early. And that next meeting is when we will have, among other items, of course, our annual infrastructure hearing. We've been collecting comments that have been coming in, and so we will have that presentation as part of that agenda. And that's great. All I have.
Great, that's it. Mr. William.
I have nothing from our office.
Mr. Please. Bennett. Nothing?
Nothing from us tonight.
No. Okay. Okay. Well, Ms. Alvarez, thank you for getting us the extra week.
I'm a little nervous about how big the agenda will be, though, if we have an extra week.
Yeah, right.
Amy, could you just, I know that the infrastructure meeting is next. Would you make sure that they put it out on social media, that put in their comments? I know they did it before, but just like a reminder that.
I did speak to the PIO last week about just putting out that reminder. So I'll touch base with her again. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, that would be great. And hopefully, here's what I'm asking, is that hopefully our next meeting, Diane Miller booked this meeting for 2.5 and we went over. And we've gone over every meeting so far. So maybe the next meeting will be the meeting we're under. Anyway.
No, I don't know about that.
Don't.
Oh, I'm
not setting
with
you, Amy, because you set the agenda.
We've been busy.
Exactly. Exactly. I'm not betting the dealer at any rate. Do any other board members have any comments before we wrap up for the evening? Nope. Okay. With that being said, I hope everybody has a good holiday on Wednesday, however you're going to celebrate it. And see you all in 5 weeks.
Yes. Thank you all.
Have a good night, everybody.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.